Thank you everyone for taking your interest at this session of questions and answers. First of all, let me apologize for not wearing a jacket. I can see that everyone else has a jacket. I have saved it for this evening's function. I have only one jacket, so I couldn't afford to wear it today. Is there anyone who's willing to set the ball rolling by... Yeah, I can see. Okay, Andrew.
Andrew Cody.
Thank you.
My question really is to the laboratories here. To ask them, we heard a lot of discussion about pigeon blood ruby, royal blue, et cetera, et cetera. Why don't we use those terms as opinions? And why don't we use a standardized colored scale like Munsell, Pantone, or, for example, Jamie Wizard? So shouldn't we really be all on one page so we have a, when we talk about a colour, everybody in the world, when they see it on a cert, if it's a GH green or whatever the reference is, then everybody around the world would know what that is by looking up Munsell, Pantone or Jamie Wizard. Why don't we do that?
A very good question. Is there anyone in the panel who would like to answer that question? Dick?
That Marcus.
That's a question for the labs, and so I'm going to let St. Paul answer that.
Andrew, I don't think it's possible to Pantoneize or Munsellized color. I mean, I think the number color coming as a number on a cert will not work. I think we have to refine what we are doing and make it into tighter parameters. I agree with that, but I don't think the color can be made as a computer-generated thing. Our beauty of the gems, it's three-dimensional, four-dimensional. It's not on a plain piece of paper, the gem. You know this.
It's about which color. There are other factors.
I tell you.
It's about which color. So if you've got a scale, why don't we refer to that scale? I know there are a lot of different factors that's three-dimensional, but that's color is only one of the dimensions that we need to talk about on a report. You can say this is the color, and we believe it to be our opinion is pigeon blood red. That's really what I'm saying. I'm not saying...
No, this I agree with completely that the labs should get together and come to, like what Nilam had suggested, come to a closer arrangement. Right now, they are completely on their own. Everyone is doing exactly what they want, and there's no unity on the color front. They have unity on the treatment front, on the species, variety. Everybody is pretty much on the same page. But color is something that, after this Congress, I hope... that they work on a little bit more and come closer on this one, for sure. What do you think?
Since Dick is here and he's heading a leading lab, why don't we have Dick's opinion on this?
People have different opinions on color, and I think St. Paul summed that up very well. I think one of the beauties of our industry is that we're not dealing with things like the diamond industry does. When I look at a precious stone, I look at a piece of art, and to try and put a number on that is like trying to measure someone's intelligence by measuring the angle of their forehead or the space between their eyes. I think it's a foolish thing to try to do, and the beauty of our industry is that the taste in precious stones is a personal choice. And I don't think that laboratories will ever come together on an issue like that, because I don't think it's possible.
Can they maybe come a bit closer, or you think it will be completely the way it is now? What is your opinion on this one?
I approach this kind of question by trying to study the history of something. And so I do a literature search on the history. If we're talking about what is pigeon's blood, what is a peacock blue, and this kind of thing. But at the same time, imagine trying to describe what is the color of the sky. It brings in a lot of questions. What time of day are we talking about? How many clouds are there? What is the latitude and so forth? Precious stones or colored stones are extremely complex objects. And as I've gotten older, I've realized that they're devilishly difficult to describe in words. And we always tell our clients, don't buy the paper, buy the gemstone. You have to use your own eyes to look at the stone and decide if that is what you like. Of course, inexperienced buyers, they'd like a professional opinion on the quality of that, a neutral opinion. And so that's one of the services that laboratories provide.
There's a gentleman over there who, have you got a mic with you?
Yes, I have one.
Okay, please go ahead.
First, I must disagree with you that you cannot put numbers on colors. If you have an experience in printing, you know that every time that you are sending some graphic design, you get numbers according to four letters, C, Y, M, X, and then the color is perfectly described and repeated. However, I agree with you that gemstones have nothing to do with these numbers because the gemstone is seen in a piece of jewelry. So it can be a little bit less red or a little bit more blue, the design and the creation of the piece of jewelry and the complexion and the way the stone is shone on the complexion of the skin is the most important thing, not the numbers. We are completely always forgetting that the final product is a piece of jewelry, not the gemstone itself. And that this is why is not so important when you describe the colors like pigeon blood or not pigeon blood. Thank you.
Anybody else in the audience who would like to express an opinion on this? Will someone, have you got a mic with you? Okay, go ahead.
I think the real question that Andrew asking is not about the number, it's not about the name of the color, but I think it's about the expand of the gem community. If you say like an expert, yeah, we have tests, we have like an art, and we can, when we see the stone, we can interpret our idea, our likes. But I think we don't want our gems to be only with us. We want everybody in the world can enjoy the color of gem, but they need guidance. I think that's the real question of Andrew.
Yeah, I'll just take opinion from... yes, please, go ahead.
Ponsawat Watanakun from the GIT. GIT is the research institute, and we contain also the lab. And for this color communication, every time we call color communication, because when we establish our institute, we receive some of the question when they call the stone's color. And I was surprised that why they have such a name, pigeon's blood, and so on, you see. But finally, instead of using this color by some group of people, but as a lab, if you can facilitate by interpreting into science, and so we have conduct our research to support this. But today you say that this makes confusion. I don't think that is fair enough to laboratories, because we create this this research to support you, at least to have the consistent and standardization, that one time you bring stone to the lab could have their standardization and systematic way in checking your stone and have the measurement. But if I say some of the scientific notation, you won't understand this. And then we interpret into your language, which our gentleman said that it's not just only for ours, it's for the public. That's why we interpret into your language and then said, this is your color name, pigeon's blood. This is your color name, royal blue and cornflower blue. It's, those names are not created by people from the Eastern like we. We have to study and learn what Dick said, that it's from the history, and then to the expert's opinion, and to you, even your family standards. Some of the family in Thailand, or even you guy here, I think you have your own standard of color, how you call among your family members as well, and among your clients. That's why I think that to be sure what the lab can help the industry is, we prepare the standardization, and once when you need, you bring to us. This year, you get your name of color. Another 10 years or the other times, you still have the same color names.
So I'll close the discussion on that subject with an opinion from Nilam.
I can get the feeling from the last 2-3 days in this Congress and listening also to the opinions today. There was a suggestion for codifying the color, and as Pon Sawat said, the labs certainly do their research, and we hope each lab through their research is consistent with their results of the report, and we appreciate that. I think the problem here is not that each lab does not do research, but can we have a harmonization of the result as much as possible between the major labs? I think this is what the problem is that the trade is facing, and it's obviously not just the trade, the labs and the trade have to get together to solve this issue, but the problem is the harmonization of the results of each lab. What each lab is doing is highly appreciated. If she's a member of a lab committee called the LMHC, to educate those who don't understand that, it's the Laboratory Manual Harmonization Committee. So it was formed, I think, about 10 years ago, exactly to do this, to harmonize the results that are given by the member labs, which is about 6 or 7 of the world's major labs. Pon Sawat's lab, GIT, is one of them. If, as you rightly said, if we can get GIA or GRS or another major, other major issuers, or any other member labs of LMHC to give us how it is possible to harmonize this, and that is what the trade is facing. Thank you.
Thank you, Nilam. That closes the discussion on that subject. If there is any other, you wish to say something else? Okay, I'll make an exception.
Thank you. James Riley from GEMA. One of the key points about laboratories is that all of their findings are based on evidential proof through testing. Even if it's country of origin, we can say there are reasons why we have this opinion. With regards to color, if you are not prepared to state why you think it is this color or what the color is according to international standards, you cease to become a laboratory, you merely become an art critic. You have to be able to justify why you think it is pigeon's blood.
Okay, thank you. Can we get on with another subject?
I'm Kamil Ismail from Sri Lanka. I just want this Chanaka to answer this question. You know, he said that we hope to reach the $1 billion mark very soon. My question is, will large-scale, foreign mining setting up in Sri Lanka help you to reach this target faster? Because you are targeting $1 billion target very soon. How will this help Sri Lanka to reach the target faster when you get set up foreigners to see starting their mining in Sri Lanka? Can you answer that for me, please?
Exactly.
Yes, I did mention that we are looking at $1 billion as our next milestone. I also qualified that by saying that value addition, especially in the form of jewelry manufacture, should play the major role in that growth that we are looking for. Having said that, to answer your question on foreign organizations mining in Sri Lanka, there are two things. One is that the regulatory framework in our country doesn't allow that. The law specifically states that mining should be done by nationals, and non-nationals are not permitted to do mining in Sri Lanka. I don't think that the present government policy would allow a change to that legal framework in the short run. So really the question of foreigners coming and mining here doesn't arise in the projection that I have made for the industry's growth. Having said that, I think also Professor Dharmaratna brought out the point that what is our mining philosophy? And our mining philosophy has been to exploit these resources in a very controlled and systematic way. And we are not really looking at exploiting the resources extremely rapidly. So in that context, it doesn't fit in with our objective. Rapid mining doesn't fit in with our objective of reaching that 1 billion target through rapid mining or exploitation of the resources. So it has to be a phased out thing. So we are looking at reaching the 1 billion target in other ways. One way is the Chinese free trade agreement that we are negotiating at the moment, which we hope will be available by the end of this year, which will open a new market for us. We are looking at value addition, as I spoke of earlier. Many speakers have spoken about the growth of demand for sapphires. I've always talked about the price gap between the price of sapphires, carat for carat, when compared to diamond or ruby or emerald. So there is potential for sapphire prices to fetch higher levels in based on the evidence of what other gemstones are fetching. So there are other avenues for us to increase our revenue rather than looking at taking more stones out of the ground more quickly.
Thank you, Shanaka. That was a rather focused question on the Sri Lankan situation. So I'd like to have some questions or some discussion on the global gem trend and in which direction we are going. You want to say something?
Yes,
on?
Yes. My name is Subramanian, editor of the New Jeweler Group. My question is on technology and machinery, the advent of technology in the industry, and the question is open to the panel. Will the advent of technology and machine tools result in oversupply and price discrimination in the market? Because yesterday we have seen some machines pouring out hundreds of gemstones in seconds. What is the future if technology and machine tools come into the industry rapidly?
This is my personal opinion, that technology is certainly very welcome. And it does not only apply to production methods. Technology can help us achieve better quality from a gemstone in other ways than what you mentioned as production. So we certainly welcome technology in getting better quality, in communicating sources, education. There are many ways that we can use, and we welcome that technology in our industry, I feel.
Anybody in the audience who wishes to comment on that question? Will technology result in oversupply and therefore depression in prices?
Uri Harel from HiGem, Israel. Regarding technology, I don't think it has done any bad problems in the diamond fields until today. All the diamond producers, all the diamond manufacturers all over the world are welcoming technology and are producing maybe more, but more accurate stones, more stones which can fit inside the jewelry of any shape and form and size, standardized or anything else. So I think it's quite welcome, and I don't see a problem with that, personally.
Well, Ian Harebottle, who's the CEO of Gemfields, has suggested the same thing, that increased production is going to provide more uses for the gemstones, and as a result, that will send prices higher. Obviously, he has a vested interest in saying that, but I think there's a lot of truth to what he said.
From my own experience, I've also seen in the past 30 years, as we've had more and more stones available, our sales have gone up. So I can say this for fact, that when we had no stones, when we did not have enough material to sell, business was smaller. Profitability is a different question altogether, but demand for the stone can only be created if we have material to show and sell. That is 100%. Unless we have a variety of stones in large quantities, we cannot open up new markets because we don't have enough material to show. So from the ground, where I have direct experience in this, 100% is that, yes, more stones creates more demand and does not make price collapse if we do it properly.
I think also there is a built-in safeguard. I think Mr. Campbell touched on this in his presentation, in that this is a rare commodity. There's limited resources. So it's only so much that technology can contribute towards the growth of supply. So there is a natural safeguard there. And when you reach that threshold, anyway, it can't do further damage. So I would agree that technology would contribute towards quality, increase in production to a certain extent would grow demand, but there is a built-in safeguard because of the limited resources. Want to say something?
Yes.
So, thank you. So I think the technology really help our industry. And also I don't see that we'll be creating any conflicts. Actually, the labor cost now is getting higher and higher. And I think there will be, we will divide into a few division of production. The very small size, definitely, we need the machine to help for mass production. That will cut down our cost. And for the very high end, we even need more higher technique to support to get a better yield and a better cutting of stones. So we will have a sector of the middle size, okay? They can't afford, the material is getting so high, they can't afford to go to the lower end cutting because the yield is very important. And also they cannot go to the very higher end for the technique to support because the high technique is very expensive. So every sector have their room to survive and we need them. So I don't see any conflict. It only help our industry, the technology. Yeah.
If there is anyone from the audience who wants the last opinion, please.
As a retailer, I think that technology allow the gemstone to be in the hand of the different class of people. If you can produce in the, millions in an hour and all that, it allow the cost to go down to the point whereby the, so to say, the working class can enjoy the stone. So effectively speaking, we actually bring them into our industry in the early stage. So as they climb up the economic ladder, they will continue to enjoy our stones. So I see a complementation there. I don't see the conflict. And if the technology allows to the point whereby the stone is actually become saturated and all that, so let it be, because then the consumer will actually decide that, well, I'm not going to have that stone because so many people is having it. So the market force is working its way into the demand anyway and all that so on. So the key point here is that it allows the lower level of consumer to come into our industry, so we should welcome technology.
I think, Kunprita, I think we are already doing that. All the lower end stones are being very much machine cut, and technology is helping in cutting everything that is below $5 a piece, $10 a piece anyway. Panyu has some huge factories there that are cutting these stones. I think the market balances out what is needed to be cut at any time, and machinery will always be welcome. So some stones cannot be cut by machine to get optimum yield and optimum beauty. The human eye is required. And where it can be done, like in an amethyst or a citrine, we are already doing it. So market forces decide this, like Kunprita said, and we are balancing this out on a day-to-day basis, for sure.
So that closes discussion on that subject. Can we move on to another subject, please? Sorry.
Hello, Kevin Whitmore, Rio Grande. I just wanted to pose a question to ICA in general and maybe AGTA. We've extolled technology, and I agree, it's great for production, but it has opened Pandora's box with treatments, undisclosed treatments, deceptions in our trade. I think everyone here agrees these are problems, and we're not participating in those problems, but we're bystanders to a constant level of undisclosed treatments, especially at the commercial end of our trade.
I mean, I think you're absolutely right that the technology of communication, I'm with a TV shopping network with a large website, and we are promoting colored stones. We're giving full disclosure on every type of disclosure, on every type of treatment. It's the way we all have to go. There's just no, you know, the hidden part of the business that the gem alchemists, I don't fault them for what they do. There's motivation for them, but the hidden side of the business of treating a gemstone and taking advantage of a profit gap because of that, that is inevitably that has to be removed. And if we want everyone to have trust in gemstones and trust in the supply chain and the colored stone industry, it just has to be, it has to be a part of our industry. Full disclosure, we sell everything at Jewelry Television, including synthetics, glass-filled rubies, sapphires for $300,000-$400,000 untreated stones. There is a market and a price for everything if it's fully disclosed. And that end of the communication, I think there's just no way to hold it back, and I think it's good for the industry.
Yeah.
So hi. That was a very interesting question. I'm sure all of you all in the trade must be having something to say about it. Disclosure. Are we disclosing well enough to the consumer? I open the discussion to members of the audience.
Elke Bear from Geneva. We made for different of our clients a mystery shopping in Geneva. So several students went around in the shops and were asking the question about colored stones, if they're heated, not heated, and so on. So as you know, probably in Geneva we have all the big brands. So it was a disaster, the results. Nearly nobody was saying what is heated. Nearly nobody was saying what is unheated, despite two or three persons. And there was really, I don't know, saying nonsense very often, even once it's for diamonds. They were saying, okay, brilliants are more expensive than diamonds. So I think there is still a lot of things to do.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I think ICA has a lot to do where this is concerned, come down aggressively with the information strategy to get the information out to the layman on the street. Yes, Ilya.
Yeah. The question, I think, was also addressed to ICA and AGTA as in organizations, and I also represent SIBJO, so we all work towards disclosure, and it is very important, as you just mentioned, and this is a company that actually does it. We have rules within these organizations. Maybe it is not followed enough, if I may put it mildly. I'm not a member of AGTA, but they are certainly pioneers in disclosing in the gem trade, not at a consumer level, but in the gem trade in the United States. If you go to the Tucson Gem Show and you go to the AGTA show, I think they are all required to put it on the display, and I buy from them, and it's always on the invoice, the trade codes that show you what treatment has been done. So the AGTA is certainly a pioneer in this. ICA has embraced it, and of course, and CIBJO also, as world rules that are required for the trade. How well it is followed, we still have a way to go. I think AGTA is showing us the way towards that.
One thing I think that we as an industry could do to help the retailers is to provide them with some basic information about each type of stone in the form of a small card, perhaps. I proposed this to the AGTA when I was working there, but the ICA could carry it out as well. If you're selling a glass-filled ruby, it should be stated on the card what are the care requirements for that, and so forth and so on. And that would give the sales associates at the retail level the basic information that they could provide the customer at the point of sale.
Dick, yes. Taking up from there, do you think ICA has a duty to get the message across to the consumer so that the consumer will ask and not wait until he's told?
I think that it's a proactive step that the ICA could do.
I think we're going to have a board meeting this afternoon, and I think this idea is very good, Dick, that we should go ahead with some basic information on a small card that we make on an ICA basis with all the known information about each type of gemstone, and we distribute it for sale or through our website or whatever to all the retailers who want to buy it. I think this is a splendid idea.
Yeah, you could make something that could be locally branded by the retailer, and it would be simple for them to prepare. Obviously, you would cover the major gemstones first. It's not like JTV where you're selling 70 different items. Most retail stores have diamonds. They have ruby, sapphire, emerald, and maybe a half a dozen other stones.
Yes.
Several questions from the audience. Yes, I'll take that gentleman right at the find. Oh, sorry. Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, about the full disclosure, I think the full disclosure to be given to the customer, we should not wait that he should ask, because he is not actually know what the stones is being treated. So if we give him the full disclosure about the stones, then we get the confidence of the customer, and if we get the confidence of the customer, we get more business, because he know what he is buying, what, how to care it, what is the repercussions after 2 years, 5 years, whether the color will stay same or not. So I think it is better always to have the customer, who is our final buyer. If he has a confidence in us, then we can sell more stones. Otherwise, it is always, I think, like what in the past happened with the emerald in USA in 97 or 98, we will lose the business or the sale.
Nilesh Shah from London. I think we have to realize the problem lies at both ends of the industry. One, at the retail, there is absolutely no willingness by retailers to train their staff. And in fact, there is a negative connotation to disclosure with retailers. They think if they give further information about a stone, and whether it's diamonds or color stones, the problem is the same. There are retailers selling irradiated diamonds as naturally fancy colored, you know, selling treated stones. They're not willing. They think if we give that information to the public will not buy. So it's a mindset, and how that can be changed across the retail industry is the question. The other problem lies that way at the beginning of the process, the treatments that are taking place in the rough, treatments at the cutting process, how do we discourage people from producing these sort of stones and then selling them at the first stage as something that they're not? And unless we address these two end problems, the middle, we can do all that we want in the middle to address the issue, but unless we address the two end parts of it, we're not going to get anywhere.
Food for thought for ICA.
I mean, there have been studies done in the United States that have shown that if you do disclose treatments in the proper way, sales are not affected. In fact, the customers become intrigued by this. And so it's all the manner in which you do it, in my opinion, anyway.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I come from China, Beijing. I'm a teacher in School of Gemology, China University of Geoscience. I joined the ICA conference in first time. I have a lot of questions about the Chinese gemstone marketing. My English is very poor, so I let my students speaking instead of me.
Thank you, everyone. Actually, we are from China, so my professor want to share some Chinese current situation in the colored gemstone from China. Nowadays, the GRS certification is very popular in China because it can show some information like Peking blood and royal blue information of the gemstone. But at the same time, some person do the business, they just trace the color of gemstone. At the same time, it causes some confusion of our Chinese custom, because the many factors in fact affect the colored gemstone, like the cutting color and and so on. So, what's a comprehensive evaluation way to lead some customer to know about the colored gemstone in an all-round way? That's my professor's question. And the next question is, the ICA Congress, which type of the gemstone will promote in China next few years? That's all, thank you.
I'll try to answer the first question first. I think gemstones are quite different from diamonds. I think we are trying to describe color, but I don't think we will be able to do much more than that for the market, because the other parts of the quality equation of a stone is very, very up to each person's opinion, like the clarity, the cut, all these things that they have managed to perfect in a diamond. I doubt it we will ever be able to do that. We will only be able to tell what the stone is, the species, the variety, and now we are attempting to do the color. We will be able to tell the treatment, but the part that you want to assess the full quality of the stone will always remain a bit of a mystery with colored stones. And the Chinese market will probably have to understand that in the longer term, that this is all we'll be able to offer. And this gem will have to be evaluated by the end consumer and the dealer with his supplier on how we treat it as a quality product or not. Did I answer the first question? Are you satisfied with that answer?
I'll just make one quick comment that the colored gemstone industry differs from the diamond industry in that with diamonds you can create master stones because you're dealing with essentially a colorless substance that's cut to very standardized proportions, and it's singly refractive, and it is generally lacking in major inclusions. With colored gemstones, you have additional factors. Everyone is cut a little bit different. Some of them have pleochroism. Many of them have inclusions of different types. I know the LMHC has tried to create master stones, but it's really, really difficult to do because of these other factors. I know for Padparaja, they even considered growing synthetic stones to create masters that would be reproducible to send around to the different laboratories. But you can't do that because you have color zoning, you have inclusions, you have pleochroism, and a bunch of other things in other kinds of stones too. So it's really tough.
So before we bring this panel discussion to a close, I'll take one more question on another subject. That subject is now closed.
We all know, as soon as we talk or discuss about the Padparaja sapphire, back of the mind, Sri Lanka comes first, that it comes from that country. As just now he mentioned that Padparaja sapphire masters, I had an opportunity a couple of years back, and I met the Honorable Concerned Ministry as well as the Chairman of Gem Corporation of Sri Lanka. And I was invited, what is the best way to find the solution for Padparaja sapphire? We in Japan have different masters in our laboratories. You, Gem Corporation, has different master for the color chart. Again, you go to Europe, you go to GIA, you go to everywhere. Everyone has different master set according to their own market or convenience. So I requested at that time also that Gem Corporation of Sri Lanka should develop a master chart, and in coordination with CIPJO, AGTA, and ICA, communicate with all the concerned laboratories in different countries. And if we can have that master chart, lots of legalities, lots of trouble and confusions will be covered. And this ICA Congress is in your country. I think you should take a lead to make this master set for everybody, for the as far as the color is concerned.
As he himself said yesterday, who owns the word? So Sri Lanka comes out with a set of master stones. There's no compulsion for some other country, traders of some other country saying, no, we throw that aside and then we have our own master set. So defining color is such a difficult thing. I don't think we are getting anywhere on that subject right now. So if there is any other issue that you would like to bring up, I would be happy to take one more question on a completely different subject, not the color. Not the color.
Sorry, the disclosure thing is something a little bit important. And I think that my beard was black when I started this business. And the very first issue at the CIPJO Congress was about enhancement. So the very first issue when ICA was born were the treatments. Now, my question is, if we, ICA, we don't take the damn leadership of this issue, we cannot expect CIPJO to do this, because CIPJO has to follow through its own rules. And those rules will lead you to be respected by all the sectors, including those damn retailers that Mr. Shah and Elke were talking about. So, you see, how long it has been taken before we define what are the few tons of glass-filled rubies being sold in the market and called them in the proper manner. They are composed material with corundum and a little bit of a color inside, and is a kind of non-stable treatment. How long it has been taken? How our market has been affected by this? Why do we have to issue certs for a 1 carat ugly, just to make sure that it has not been treated by glass? I mean, this is a factor, and I'm talking only about rubies, the rest is there, including the diamonds that have been mentioned before. So I think this is an issue that has to be brought up by the ICA. If you want to be that international body that we're supposed to be, that's it, I'm sorry.
Thank you very much for engaging in that very lively discussion. I'd like to thank the audience for the interesting questions posed,
and the panelists Jay, Kamal, Dick, Sanpal, Shanaka, and Wilson for having assisted us with the providing answers as far as possible, as much as they could, to all of you all. I hope you all enjoyed this discussion. Thank you very much.